to the party.
Hi, everybody. Well, hello, survivors. Welcome to the State of Decay 2 stream. I am Joe Swerner. I am your customer advocate, and I am your host today for as we go forward. Now, we've got a few things that we're going to be talking about. I don't know if it's ready or up yet, but we are going to be doing a drawing today, in case you missed that. Just type /enter into chat to enroll in the drawing. And then when you're done, I can figure this out. One of those things. Over here, this is the stuff. This is the stuff that we're handing out. So we've got some pins and stickers and a badge patch down there. But we will have a giveaway. It will be up at some point, and we'll get there. So if it's not active right now, we've got most of the stream to get through it. So it will be there. Okay. Now, let's talk about what we're doing for the rest of the stream. This is our 26th quarantine stream, y'all. And I don't know about you, but that means a little something. And so, you know, we're talking shop with Kerry McCoy today, and we're going to be talking about QA, its role in development, and how we're prepping for update 22 and forward as we go forward. Essentially, we're going to be also giving you an update on the very nasty bug that went out with update 21. And this past weekend, many of you also participated in the Xbox Hall of Fame. We thank you for all of your entries, and while we'll not be able to share their identity, we will share the winning time. As of yesterday, the best time turned in for the Zombie Slayer event was 398 seconds. 6 minutes, 38 seconds, folks. Amazing work. Nice job. That was amazing. 6 minutes and 38 seconds. Again, not much that we can say, but that same person, I will say this, that same person we know, they logged a time on Friday just as soon as they could, and they got it at 8 minutes, and they spent the weekend getting that time down and working to get better. So they did a great job. So all right. Also, Halloween, everybody's favorite holiday, is only 12 days away, and we've got some special plans coming up. We've got the Fearsome Footage Pack that was going to return, which should be communicated, I think, in your Cash Beaumont thingy. And we also have a contest in the works to accompany it. More information on that later. But basically, get your survivors prepped and get ready to get spoopy again this Halloween. So, and also, don't forget the drawing. We got this drawing thing here, and we'll announce some winners at the end of the stream. Exclamation point enter to join the raffle, and you don't have to be here, but you do need to contact us when it's done. And whoever the winners are. Our mods will reach out to you and let you know who to get hold of. Okay, so introducing our guest today, our absolutely 100% special guest, is Mr. Kerry McCoy up there in the other corner.
Hello, everybody.
And Kerry is our QA manager, and we're going to be talking to him today about the general idea of QA, like the general process, not just here, but lots of different places, so like big in general. And then we're going to be talking about some very specific bugs, ones that he finds funny that we never shipped, and then a couple that maybe aren't so funny that are out there right now and annoying people, but we're also working on getting those fixed immediately, I can guarantee you. So, and of course, the ever-impressive Brant Fitzgerald is here, our wonderful brand champion. Look at this guy. Look at this guy.
It's great to be here. It's great. I've eaten Geoffrey, and I'm not feeling so good.
Oh, our juggernaut apparently has eaten Geoffrey until next week. All right. So, Mark with the diss on Brant.
Oh, ouch.
Look at that.
It's 100% right, though.
All right. So, we did not do the thing. Okay, so press any key to continue. Let's not press any keys. Let's press the button. Uh-oh. I may have screwed this up. All right. Excellent job. Excellent job. I'm a very controller-centric person, so I have to. And I'm a very PS4 controller-centric person, so I have to do some weird stuff with my controller. Sorry about that, folks.
Oh, apparently someone named Vitus called out that I think I'm saying that right. Vitus says that I have a pretty kick-ass beard. Thank you very much.
Yeah, we're
100%
getting
organic.
Definitely getting some beard love for Gary here.
I mean, as you can see, I've been stuck out in the mountains for a long time. Just kind of going with the whole mountain man motif at this point, just kind of working with it. Feels good. Feels warm. My chin stays nice and toasty. Ready for the winter.
It's a glorious beard, Kerry. Glorious.
All right. Kerry, did you ever send me that friend invite?
I did, or I followed you, as it were.
Angel Eyes, I don't think I could grow my beard as long as Kerry's.
Is it just undead Kerry?
Yeah. That's me.
I followed you back. So, let's see how this goes. Hopefully we aren't doing any troubleshooting right off the bat. Cause that was sad. Of course, the one thing that I forgot to do.
It would be a good example of, how QA works. Find the root of the problem.
Identify problem first. Problem discovered.
See if you can reproduce the issue.
Heck.
Albino Rhino, we already discussed, we already said the we haven't said who won, but we acknowledged the fastest time that was turned in already. So if you're just joining us, what was it, six something?
398 seconds, or 6 minutes, minutes, 38 seconds.
That's insane.
Yeah. So good. All right. So I sent you invite, Kerry. Did you get that?
I did. I should be on my way.
Okay. So then now we will switch over. Everybody can see my stuff. See my game and listen to all my people shooting.
I bring my dear friend Travis potentially to die.
Excellent.
He's a young survivor who has very little experience here. Into a nightmare world. Hey neighbor,
we found a location for it would be really interesting to get some telemetry on just how many plague carts were destroyed in the last weekend worldwide.
I think there's already an ask on that. I didn't look in the analytics channel before I did this, but yeah, I think there's already an ask on it. All right, I'm gonna grab some gas. This repair kit, and I'm going to grab some fire because I don't know what we're going to be doing. I also need to grab a follower. I don't know who I want to take with me. We'll take we got Dot here. All right, whoever this is up here that's just firing away. Ramirez, let's go.
Nice to see you.
Let's go. She's busy shooting. Something somewhere. Not sure what.
She's protecting your base from the monsters behind the rocks over there.
Right, well, at least she's not protecting my base from the rocks anymore. Which was a thing, right?
Like, sweet ride.
We, a couple
that was an exciting one. fun. Just endless shooting. Great for people who just like that ambient noise of gunfire, but
right.
Can't imagine that's too common.
Exactly. All right, so Kerry, you said that there were a couple of bugs that you wanted to talk about that UA had made sure that we did not ship. Some funny ones.
I figured I could bring up some of the more fun bugs that we thankfully did not ship, because most of them were pretty crazy. I think I'll save my favorite for last and start with the one I like to call timeout. It was an issue where when you did an emotional moment with one of your community members, for example, if you killed a character that had the plague or you exiled someone, you would be sent, your active character and the character you were exiling would be sent to a different part of the map on just this random gray platform floating in the middle of nowhere while you finished up your emotional moment, and you would then just be stuck there in timeout, essentially. It was a very special bug. A lot of fun to kind of figure out like what was causing it, breaking down the repro steps, etc. But we made sure that one got fixed before we pushed anything out. Another one is a fun issue where your active character used to get pulled for missions, which would just be in the middle of doing whatever. A mission would show up and it would be assigned to your active character, and your character would just disappear from your control. And your camera would just be stuck floating there. And you'd be hard locked or soft locked at that point. And a soft lock is when you can no longer proceed within the game without exiting and going back in, but everything else is still going on around you. You would essentially be soft locked in that area unless you happen to be in an outpost or your home site and able to switch to another character. that one was a lot of fun. But I think my all-time favorite bug was the one I call the pancake car. The way it worked was your car, when it took damage, would just become extremely distorted. The wheels would fly off, would just kind of be anchored in really random directions, not appearing to be associated with anything in particular. The car itself would start to flatten to the ground. The best part about this bug is your vehicle seemed to be indestructible, which was cool. The problem was it would continue to stretch outward and longward and becoming flat and just go all the way. You'd have this giant monster of a car just surfing around your map. It was amazing.
I think I've seen video of that. One of these times we should try to get that in front of folks. But the,
I could
giant,
probably get that for you.
The giant pancake car.
All-time favorite of mine.
Right, it's just wait, like, drive. Oh, you can drive if you want, I suppose.
I don't want to drive.
But, in general, when it comes to sort of like these QA processes, how do you know what to test, and how do you design that kind of stuff?
I've been doing this for, I kind of lost track after I started working here. It's some 13 plus years of testing. It didn't all start out with me like designing the tests. A lot of the early work I did was just running tests that were designed for me. But a lot of it just comes from experience and like working closely with the developer and kind of getting an idea of what the expectation of the new feature that's coming out is going to be. And then you use that to kind of get the knowledge of like, okay, well, we know what shouldn't work. Let's think of ways that we can break the system to make things, you know, that would be impacted by this particular feature kind of fall apart and turn into something interesting. I don't know if any of you have ever played a game with the express purpose of trying to see if you can break something. That's kind of how we do a lot of our work, is we focus on, like, we know that this feature is tied to text, for example. So if we go around and mess with text in ways that would, you know, potentially break this feature, we will then take that and write it as what we call a test case, which we would then build into a giant pass of multiple test cases and then run that against the game.
So Once you write those, what do you mean by run that against the game?
Yeah, so we would we'd have the test cases put together, then we would get into the game. Oftentimes we would use a build that has a lot of debug hooks, which allow us to sort of change things in our favor, add characters, give us infinite health if we need it, etc. And then we would go through the tests and try to use those to break the game. Going into the new feature, and as I described, finding a way to twist the system in our favor to see if we can break it. Knowing that, like, certain things could impact it. Like, for example, if we add a bunch of new missions, doing things like intentionally getting a character that's important to the mission killed before we finish the mission and seeing how the mission reacts to that.
Right on. Okay, so where are we at? So there's beyond just the things that the scenarios that you can think of, how would you define something that's out there called ad hoc tests? Like, at what point at what point are some people really, I mean, I know that, like, from my personal experience, some people are really good at it, and others, especially those who don't have a lot of experience, aren't necessarily there yet. How do you define sort of like ad hoc testing, and when is it the most useful?
Yeah, so ad hoc testing is the idea behind it, at least how I would like to imagine it. I think everyone kind of does ad hoc a little bit differently. But ad hoc is generally just kind of free-form testing, where you don't necessarily follow a strict set of cases. But instead, you kind of like knowing how the feature functions, knowing how the game works, and everything associated with it, you kind of go in there and just free test things. Oftentimes, one of the simplest ways to do this is to just play like how you would imagine a regular player would play it. If they have some idea, like, you know, a lot of players like to go in here and see if they can exploit systems, so we do similar things. And that's generally what ad hoc testing is, just a more free form, not scripted sort of testing. And if to answer your question about, like, when is it most useful, oftentimes after you've done a lot more of the targeted testing and you found those scenarios that are, you know, more, like, easily, like, figured out in, like, a simple, very straightforward way, you would later then, like, to kind of do a more of a polished pass, you'd spend some time ad-hocking around it. A lot of what I would consider beta testing is pretty ad hoc testing. There's no real direct. A lot of times, that would maybe be more like a directed ad hoc, where we kind of give people an idea of a specific area to test around. Whereas general ad hoc is just like pretty much just playing the game. And there's always value behind it, because sometimes, like, you can be as creative as you want. I am not going to help you with these guys.
That's why I brought a follower. You saw how much effort I had to put into it.
I might have to get a gun. Yeah, if you got any extra guns.
Oh yeah, I've got plenty of extra guns. I might have already grabbed this one though. Nope.
Yeah. So. Whatever
this is. I get all my bugs from Geoffrey through ad hoc.
Yes, exactly. So well, a lot of devs do ad hoc testing for us, which is fantastic. Because they'll just like play through they're generally going into playing games. Give the other devs feedback on how certain things feel. But oftentimes we'll find bugs while doing that. And that would be basically ad hoc testing.
Well, it's not a gun, but here's a bastard sword.
Hey.
And a bottle of tequila for when you run
out.
Hey!
That's two things I always like to mix. Bastard sword and a bottle of tequila.
Very sharp thing that makes me react poorly. Awesome.
Does that just get your Scottish blood boiling?
So, Gary, now, so let's say you've gone through the steps and everything, and you've done your bit with the testing, and you've actually found a bug. So, what is your advice or guidelines, I guess, in terms of like telling either new testers or even just whoever, like what to expect from a good bug. Like what's the bare minimum type of stuff?
Yeah, so there's two, in my opinion, extremely important parts to a bug. And the main thing for me is what we call repro steps, which are the ability to describe to someone who may not understand the game super well how to reproduce the issue. So in pretty strong detail, we'll break down step by step what causes the issue, like how to get from point A to point B. Like, it's even going as far as saying things like launch the game, create a new community, you know, go through the tutorial, find a screamer zombie and kill it with a close combat weapon. Like, those are pretty loose ones. Like, you could get even, it's even better the more detail you can give. And because of that, a big part of testing involves reproducing the issue. So you'll see it for the first time. Do your best to capture some kind of media for it, take a screenshot, get a video. And then you want to try and reproduce it a few times. Is it something you can reproduce every time following the certain set of steps? If yes, there's your repro steps. If not, we'll spend some time investigating. What were we doing that could have caused this? It obviously wasn't what I originally thought. So I'm going to go back and keep doing these different steps until I can figure out, okay, I've narrowed it down. It wasn't killing it with a close combat weapon that was important. It was the fact that I did it while it was at the apex of its screen or something like that, right? So that's kind of a big part of testing, is getting nailing down the repro steps. The second most important thing, what are you guys shooting at? It's the getting some kind of media, some way to like show whoever needs to fix this, the producers who need to, you know, prioritize the bug, kind of showing them what is the issue so they can see it clearly. Oftentimes videos are the best way to do it. Screenshots can help sometimes as well, depending on, you know, what the issue is.
Nice.
Joe, there's a lot of questions about what character you have that's doing that front pull down finisher move.
This is Dot. She's a cowgirl, as you can see. That's not the important part. She's a red talon. But the big thing is like you could do this with a regular survivor if you have powerhouse. But you'll notice that she's got standing execution with a heavy weapon. That's basically all that is. So it's basically the powerhouse stuff, and she's got a heavy weapon equipped in the form of this coffee can mace. So we put the what used to be close combat finisher, we put that on the heavy weapon for people who had maxed out powerhouse, or in this case maxed out prowess for the red talon survivors. All right, so Kerry, I guess what makes a good bug?
Everything's
good
when
bug. when we're trying to decide which ones to fix, right? No matter where we are, like what, no matter what studio you've worked for, what is it that what's the big thing in terms of like deciding factors for what and when something gets fixed?
So there's generally two things we'll look at when we're trying to decide like how quickly a bug should get fixed. And the first comes from the QA tester, which is when they enter in the severity of the issue. And that we usually have a numbered system for that, where the highest number is the more severe the issue is, and the lower the number, the less severe it is. Or sorry, the other way around. The lower the number, the more severe it is. The higher the number, the less severe it is. And the way that generally works is we'll keep certain issues that are extremely devastating to the game, like crashes, data loss, stuff like that, will have a much lower severity. So like a 1 severity would be where a lot of those things would fall. And that really like really helps us determine. Lower things like text bugs, some grammar things, some art stuff that's not super noticeable, those will generally fall on on like a higher number, like five. And so that'll be measured against the production team and triage. Triage is when we take bugs, look them over, and decide like what priority they fall under. And while doing triage, we'll consider the priority of, or sorry, the severity of the issue. The second thing we look at is the priority, and those are generally set based off of things like how many people we have that are able to fix this issue versus how impactful the issue is to players, how much it, how many players will encounter it, because we'll find bugs that like have a very small chance of happening, and those tend to they can be damaging and will still have a severity as if it was, you know, 100% regardless. But the priority may be lower simply because very, very few people will actually encounter the issue. If it's bad enough, we don't drop a priority any lower than like a one or two. For example, like data loss is always taken seriously regardless of how many people run into it. Serious crashes, same thing. Those are things that just have to get fixed immediately. But those are generally what'll determine it. Like how many people are impacted by it, how severely does it impact a person's gameplay? Those are generally measurements that we take into account when we decide how quickly we need to fix an issue.
Okay,
and we have a lot of bugs, guys, and it's not feasible to fix them all. Though I would love for every single bug to get fixed, we do have to make decisions on which ones we need to fix first.
Yeah. And so you had mentioned this like triage process. Could you say a little bit more about that?
Yeah. So we'll get some people that are, you know, invested in the issue together and kind of discuss like where we feel it should fall on like the priority list in terms of getting fixed, things of in terms of like what content update we will add them to, and like who should be fixing it. And it's usually like QA and production will get together and talk this stuff out. Sometimes you'll throw in some engineers or other devs, depending on, you know, where you're working or what you're working on at the time. So everyone will get together and, you know, production's main goal, like they have to manage the time of the studio, right? And releases and things like that. Whereas QA is focused on, you know, the quality, making sure that the game is fun for the player and that there's not a lot of nasty stuff going on. So those are kind of conflicting ideals. So it's kind of nice to, not necessarily conflicting, but oftentimes like they don't go hand in hand. So that's why we have the two different groups in there so that we can discuss it and come to a decision on whether or not this is something that needs to get fixed immediately, or it's something that can be potentially like put off to a later date. With production, you know, they have a good mind for timing and, you know, how much time it will take for each developer to finish a thing. But they, you know, they need QA to be in there to tell them like, well, here's what this actually does. Here, how this impacts players, why players will see this more often, et cetera.
All right. So, let's see, where are we at now in the notes? All right. So there are a couple of things that I wanted to talk about when we're in triage. Like we've talked about like what gets fixed, right? Really big ones. How do we decide whether something goes into an update, whether or not that goes into the backlog, or whether overall it's a just we will never end up being able to fix. Or just won't.
I mean, it all like it's all dependent on a lot of variables. You know, certain content is just not touched as often. A lot of that information we get from data. A lot of that information we get from our active players. And in cases like that, if it's a low enough severity bug, we'll sometimes, you know, push it off. But that's something, you know, I'm not a huge fan of the whole won't fix
right.
terminology. I've said this my whole life as a QA tester. It's very difficult for me to make that decision. But ultimately, you know, sometimes you have to compromise. And there are just some issues that just are so rarely encountered and just have such little impact on the game that we just have to focus on other things and not stress about these issues.
So, Kerry, are you saying that you don't like it when I send back all my bugs with won't fix? I've been doing it wrong this whole time.
So it was you, Brant. I was wondering.
Dang it.
Well, I mean, won't fix art my ways. Like, I don't know.
But yeah, that's part of what triage is, right? Like we have those discussions and make those decisions during triage. And oftentimes, like, you know, we will try to set
you a present.
Ooh, what'd you bring me? You got guns?
I got guns and ammo.
Yeah. Feeling good now. Oh, I don't want to talk to you. Sorry. So, you know, and a lot of times we'll circle back. We also do this thing to help reduce the amount of issues we have stacked up on us. We have a team go in and do what we call a bug scrub, where they'll actually go through a lot of our older issues that have just kind of been, you know, waiting to be fixed. Their priorities may be super low or something. And we'll have them like attempt to reproduce the issues. A lot of times we'll find that these bugs that have been kind of sitting in the backlog waiting to get fixed, were just fixed while other issues were being fixed or new features were being added, et cetera. So that's also a nice little thing to do because it saves, you know, the devs a whole lot of time if we can narrow down their buckets of bugs that they all get to sit on.
Yeah. Well, and having that backlog on your conscience can't be easy. All right. So, before we launch into, all right. So now the absolute worst has happened, right? A bug goes live, that we didn't necessarily want out there. Nope, let me take that back. A bug goes live, and we miscalculated how annoying it would be for players. What would you suggest people do at that point?
I mean, the main thing to do is you know, try to get that information to us as quickly as possible. Use the Zendesk desk tool that's on our website. Try to gather as much information about the issue as you can so that, you know, as soon as it gets into our hands, we can focus on narrowing it down and getting it ready for the devs. You know, it's not ideal. We never want to ship things like that. It's frustrating, but you guys can really, really help us out if you have, you know, access to Zendesk and the website. And just kind of get us whatever information you need. Because it allows us to take less time, you know, broadly testing around the thing and gives us some narrowed areas that we can kind of focus our testing on to really find those repro steps I was talking about earlier. And once we have that, the devs are going to have a much easier time finding the problem in their code or content or whatever, and then be able to fix it for you guys all the sooner. Which, by the way, the whole beta testing thing and you guys getting us bugs in Zendesk, we really appreciate that. That stuff is super, super helpful. We've definitely gotten some issues that we were having trouble getting fixed because of the information that we've gotten from the community. Or just learned that a bug was more severe than we realized,
to
you guys.
Let's see. So I don't have a link ready for you, but the link is should also be in the help and support section of your pause menu. So when you bring up your pause menu and you go into settings like this, it should be right here in help and support. You should be able to either just scan that QR code into your phone and it should take you straight to support.stateofdecay.com, or you can access it directly on your web browser by going to support.stateofdecay.com. We put this stuff in the game so that people would use it. We tried to make it as convenient as possible. And so if you do run into an issue that you find it just isn't getting addressed and you really want to see it addressed and it's super annoying for you, I bet you're not the only person. So go ahead, go to support.stateofdecay.com, submit a bug report, and you know, let the people like me, the customer advocate, start to advocate for you, right? It's a lot easier if you come to us than me having to find it in some large bug thread on Reddit.
And on that note, like, here's another secret, guys. Production's gonna have a harder time fighting me on getting a bug fixed if we have a bunch of custom reports.
Exactly.
So submit those things.
Now, So our customer advocates in support of our QA efforts here, generally what we do is we group the like reports together. We will do an initial investigation, which is a lot easier when the initial description is a little more detailed. But that said, like, we know the game pretty well, and so you tell us, well, this thing happened at such and such a place and doing such and such a thing, even if it's not that necessarily, like, that gives me a general direction to go, and then I can also help push on back on that, and we can start getting those tickets in. So, you know, you guys, we're a living community, and we depend on each other to sort of get through it here. All right, let's see if we can't get you some status. Let's go kill this infestation over here, shall we?
Yes. Time to fight.
All right, let's see what we've got here. Brant, how are we doing on questions? Anything?
There's lots of questions about SOD3. There's lots of questions about the Hall of Fame stuff. Today, we're mostly answering questions that are related to Kerry, since we actually have him here, and QA stuff. So, yes, we do read the chat, but often we want to limit the questions that are pertinent to our special guests, especially since we don't get Kerry on very often. Because most of the time, I believe he's just grooming his glorious beard.
Grooming the beard, stuck in the mountains. It's hard to get a hold of me.
That's right. Here's a good question from Fall Down. What are the most important things to put into a bug ticket?
Yes, so we talked about this a little bit earlier in the stream. You might not have been here, but my two main things that I would love to ensure are in bugs if possible is your repro steps. Your basically the way you describe how the issue happened to the best of your knowledge. That'll really help, both the devs and QA able to reproduce it and find the root cause of the issue. And then media, and what I mean by that is screenshots and video of the issue, so we can really get an idea of the severity of the problem, what it looks like, and that'll also help us when reproducing it, because we'll be able to see, oh yeah, that's what we're seeing now. Okay, I think I know how this is happening. There's one more guy left. Those are my two key things for bugs that I would really, really make sure are in them, and my team understands it's the priority to have those if possible.
What's the funniest bug you've ever had, Kerry?
Ever had? I'm not sure how much I could talk about some of the other studios we've worked for, so we'll stick with Undead Labs. But it's definitely the pancake car I was talking about earlier. The car that basically got super deformed the more damage it took, and it was it was interesting because the car seemed to be indestructible. It would take damage, but it wouldn't explode. But every time it took damage, it would shrink lower to the ground and spread out, basically becoming this gigantic monstrosity of a flat vehicle that you could drive around the map. It was crazy. And the funny part is, the zombies would still, jump on and latch on, but they would be just, on the edge of this massive car.
Do we have video of that?
We do. Somewhere. It's tucked away. I can probably find it for you guys at some point.
Someday we should probably do a greatest hits.
I know we have a whole QA's best bucket of bugs sometime. You guys should go through that and share some of
them. Ow. Alright. What on earth? Okay.
No, sir.
Come on, Ramirez. Get out of there.
Not one. This 22 is not doing anything in this journey.
That's alright. I'm actually having to try. Alright.
I just realized that my character really, really badly needs a nap.
Well, I mean, we understand we have a couple of rookies playing the game right here, so I mean, we'll.
And you, what is this thing?
What are the controls again?
Definitely kill that guy. Okay, shut him up.
All right.
I'm gonna go ahead and let you deal with these big nasty boys while I.
The nasty boys are down.
I told you I was hiding in the corner. That's exactly what I'm doing right now.
All right, so the nasty boys are down. All right, come on, Ramirez. There we go. I'm sure she's nice and hurt.
So, Kerry, do you want to describe what automated testing does and what it means for us?
Oh yeah. So automated testing. I'm super excited for this. So. As I'm sure some of you have been with this, listening to this stream this whole time, I have kind of gotten an idea of is that testing can be very redundant. Oh, no! Very redundant. There's a lot of doing the same stuff over and over and over again. This becomes extremely time-consuming. And in a lot of scenarios, it's not... while it's valuable to do the test, it's not efficient time-wise for all of our testers to constantly be doing a thing. We do these things called build verification tests, where when a new build comes up, we check to make sure the build is stable. There's no major issues for like most of the key points of this. I gotta go change my character. Things like that are time consuming but valuable. And when we get some automated testing, what we can do is create scripts that will run these BBTs for us, allowing us to focus on other bigger things like feature testing and stuff like that, saving us a ton of time and allowing us to get more coverage on things that, you know, we may have to, like, that basically are extremely time consuming. It allows us to just put it off to the side and let the computer basically test it for us. It's amazing, and I'm super looking forward to it. On that note, one of the things that we recently released, the different sliders, created a lot of variables that should be tested, but it is nearly inconceivable for us to do manually. So having a way to automate those tests to cover each one of those variables will save us an immense amount of time and make sure that those areas are all covered.
So there's a comment here that I will take. I'm curious, Mod Complex asks, I'm curious about what support for State of Decay 2 looks like in the next 6 to 12 months. I know this isn't related to our topic today, but all we can say is, yes, there's more in store than just, you know, new cosmetics and things like that. As Geoffrey has said before on the stream, we have several teams working on both large and small things. And obviously the large things take longer. But we have great plans for supporting State of Decay 2 from now to the foreseeable future. And that's about all I can say about that. Let's see. Kerry, what's the usual size of QA teams you've worked on?
It really depends on the role the QA team is taking. Because, that can actually vary quite a bit. Ranging from testers that generally will just focus on running test cases and BBTs, a lot of times those teams will be fairly larger because you'll need a lot more people to get the coverage you need. If you're on teams that are mainly focused on building test plans and creating the test cases and test suites and such, those teams tend to be a little bit smaller. It requires less people to do that work. But I would say it varies. Like internally, we have a smaller team, but we also work very closely with, Microsoft is supporting us with the team that we work really closely with. And they're, I think, like 12 strong. And they've been incredibly amazing in helping us get through stuff. But I would say on average, they range between 8 and 12 in size per project. So I would say that's about what I would expect to see a QA team size.
And so let's stretch that out. So like, let's say that a game takes 3 years to develop, right? And let's say they work, those folks work 50 weeks out of the year, and then only 40 hours a week. So that's 2,000 hours, 6,000 hours over the course of 3 years per person. You multiply that by the top there, that's 72,000 hours. That's a lot of time, though, right, Kerry? But
not enough.
Right. And so sometimes things do make it through. And this was probably one of my favorite things that as a person who also came up through QA, this is one of my favorite things to point out is that if you say, let's say you sell 100,000 copies, right? Just 100,000. We're not going for millions yet. And each person plays 2 hours right when it's launched. You've already, in the span of 1 hour, the customers have already played more of the game, at least hours-wise, than the testers did for the entire life of the project. And yep. So QA is important, don't get me wrong. Like testing features and making sure things are hooked up, and there are a lot of things like Pancake Car that just never make it out because of what the yeoman's work that our QA team does, any QA team does really. And sometimes I feel like it doesn't quite get the credit that it deserves. Like for instance, where are we at in terms of time? We're cutting it pretty close. Okay, so there are a couple of bugs that are active right now that I know that are being worked on, and I had alluded to this earlier in the stream. Now, I am going to... I've got a follower here, and Ramirez is pretty well... She's pretty well stacked out, but you can see here that she's got a hunting crossbow. Now, I don't generally keep hunting crossbows. I might have one. And then just for the purposes of this test, we're going to put this in here. One bug that somebody came across with this, and it's taking this red talon. So if you take their backpack, their stuff doesn't come into your inventory, so it looks like it was actually deleted. Now, this bug is being worked on, so it won't be around for that much longer. However... as we go back inside here, we'll go back to my supply locker. And you notice there was also like an advanced, there was an advanced thing. All right, so we come down here, and sure enough, there's my hunting crossbow with a standard bolt in it. So even though I was outside the confines of my base, and my survivor now no longer has a backpack, the stuff isn't actually deleted. It goes straight to your supply locker. So, you know, that's another thing that you should be looking out for is when Kerry was talking about impact, sometimes bugs make it out. And because the overall impact is less than other things that we had found, even something that seems destructive like this, which isn't really that destructive, as you can see, it sometimes, you know, catches people off guard, that it's there at all. And so, you know, that's one of the things that you should probably check is if anything seems like it got deleted, check your supply locker, because chances are it showed up there anyway. All right. So that was bug number one that I know is being worked on,
okay.
And very diligently by our development team. And then the other one that I wanted to point out actually requires Kerry to follow me.
I'm coming.
Okay, so as you can see, I'm the host of this session. I can crash through a door. I'll even crash through another door because we're still within shooting range. I hope this one works out. And then another one that we are definitely working on. Okay, Kerry, There's a door back here. You would try crashing through it.
Here I come.
So we have noted this.
Pardon me, Dot.
Dot's in the way. She's doing great work. Favorite thing
was to come on. Whole
so as you can see, clients can't smash most through the doorways right now, but they can open them. They're not locked and all of that fun stuff. So anyway, those are just a couple of the bugs that I know that are live that we are working on. And that comes from you guys engaging with us and letting us know things. And, you know, we listen, we love you, and we appreciate the fact that you guys pay close attention. And so know that we are working on both of those things, as we go forward. All right. So we're also coming close to the end of the stream, so I need to poke at Megan here really quick. And all right, so the entries, I didn't remind you guys enough, I suppose. All right, so sorry you guys, don't Megan, I was not paying attention. You're going to draw at 3:55. Oh, okay. Thank you, Megan. Sorry. All right. So we've got a few more minutes to go out and shoot stuff.
Yeah, all right. But remind everybody to enter the.
Oh, right. Yes. So if you haven't already, we are coming down to the wire for the entry. I'm going to shoot the camera back up really quick. Reminder that there. Okay, so type enter into chat to enroll in today's drawing if you haven't already. The prizes that are up for grabs are right here. There, you get some pins or a sticker or something to that effect. We'll be mailing them out as we can. That's time to 3:55. Yeah, way to go, Sailor Wolf. Try to cheat your way through it. So anyway, just poking around and making sure that we are on track. All right, so now we go back to the game for a few more minutes, and then we'll talk about, I don't know what we'll talk about.
I saw a couple quick questions. What's worse, a bug that takes a long time to fix or some kind of update that spawns several small bugs? That's an interesting one. I would say the bug that's hard to fix, because honestly that ends up taking a lot of time from both the QA team and the development team, because you know we have to spend time trying to narrow down what's causing the issue, because that's usually what makes a bug take a lot longer to fix, is not knowing why it's happening. So we spend a lot of time trying to figure that out, and the development team spends a lot of time doing the same. And those are just really, really rough on the whole team, because that prevents us from continuing a lot of the other work we need to do. Smaller issues, it's not ideal. We don't want to ship a game with a bunch of small, or an update with a bunch of small issues, but it does happen sometimes. It's a lot easier to deal with a lot of small issues we know how to fix than it is one issue that's just eluding us completely.
Case in point was the... For those of you who played with us a long time, was the audio bug last, what, a year and a half ago or so?
Oh, boy.
Oh, when it would just melt your ears off. We knew it was happening, but we couldn't track it down. And it was really frustrating for everybody. Not just the people who encountered it, but for us too. You know, like it's not something that, We listened and we heard you, and then we eventually did get those reproductions that we talked about earlier on, and so we did get those reproductions, figured it out, and moved on with life. And because once we have the good reproduction, like Kerry was saying earlier, those steps are so important, and the reason being, like, knowing which steps it is, you go through and you find that step, gotten to that 100%, we go, oh, dang, that's what it was. And so when we figured out exactly what it was that was causing it, that's how we get it to the, that's how we get it to,
if we get any more the, in around here, we the might want to move phase. Out.
We've got our winners.
All right, looks like we've got some winners in YouTube.
Yep, Alex Egan, Console Freak, and Booze. Congratulations.
Right on. So, Booze wins a pin. No, I'm just joking. All right. So, congratulations to the winners. We've got our drawing. That's at three. That's done at. What was the repro for the audio bug? If I remember correctly, the best way for us to do it was to go out and play multiplayer for about 45 minutes to an hour, and then somebody goes and plays solo. And then once you did that, like your audio was just done. And of course, you know, people who played multiplayer, they would go back and they would play solo a lot, and so a lot of people would run into that bug.
I thought it was because we hadn't sacrificed enough chickens to the elder gods.
Oh, yeah, well, Cthulhu was not happy.
That's right.
True. To be fair, I'm glad we upped our chicken count on those sacrifices. It's definitely been a lot more entertaining and delicious.
Right. I'd like to state for the record that no chickens were harmed during development of State of Decay.
Well, no real chickens, just the rubber one. Just the rubber one.
Yeah.
So, let's see, the other bugs that got fixed, speaking of bugs that are hard to fix, was the one where your car would basically be launched into space. You remember that, Brant?
Oh my god.
And now, instead of being launched out into space, you're only launched like a block or two. No big deal. But, I mean...
The car stays in okay shape.
Right. That's a lot better. And, right. The car is much better off, and you don't get thrown out of the map. So it's super good. And we're always working to make things better here, you know. So more facial hair on characters. Yeah, okay.
Hey, I'm gonna go out for a bit. I'll be back later.
We've already talked about beards a million times, but okay. Let's see. So when it comes to QA, hopefully we have proven beyond a doubt that it's super important to the development process, that you guys are sort of the last line of defense when it comes to things that, especially the ones that are minor, but ends up being super annoying. For those of you who were winners, make sure that you reach out. I'm pretty sure Megan or somebody is going to be messaging you about when it's about to come out, so about how to contact her so that she can get you your stuff. Where are we at? Checks notes. We are at the end. All right, so we completed our patch. Oh right, I forgot to update about the very nasty bug. I'm sorry, folks. So, very nasty bug that went out with 21. We completed our patch. People should have received their compensation in the form of free prestige. Thank you for your patience and understanding as we work this one out. And, of course, quick reminder that it's Halloween, our favorite holiday. Hopefully one of yours as well. Which means that we're going to have a contest and that the Fearsome Footage Pack is coming back. I want to say a heartfelt thank you to everybody for being here. It's super awesome that I get to host this thing and with these wonderful people. So thank you from the bottom of my heart. Kerry.
Yes, sir.
What would you like to say to the people as we sign off today?
First off, sorry for all of those that were impacted by the big nasty bug. Glad we could get that fixed for you guys. And do some make goods for those of you who may have already, gotten into a destructive state. So apologies there. But ultimately, you know, we work very hard to make sure the game comes out pretty clean. And it was actually quite a joy to come on here and answer questions for you guys. And I think I might have to do it again in the future. Hopefully a nearer future than the last time I was on. But thank you everybody for enjoying our game. We love you guys. You're amazing. And we're going to keep working hard for you. We have a lot of processes being changed within QA, so hopefully our future will be cleaner and cleaner as we move along.
All right. Thank you, Kerry. And of course, last and something, Brant.
Thank you for that, Joe. Actually, I was hoping we might introduce a bug like that with every update because I could use the prestige each time.
Just give it out free.
No, as usual, thanks to our friends both on YouTube, on Twitch, and those of you watching the video later on. As always, we couldn't do this without your support, and we love you. So thanks for joining us today. Really appreciate it.
All right, everybody. Thank you very much. Brant, Kerry, everybody. It's been a wonderful day. We are now going to head on out for our outro. We'll see. We'll be back next week with a few more details about some stuff that's coming. We promise.
It's so awkward. How do we end this stream? We'd never know. We just don't know.
Snacks?
Kerry, I'll pay you $5 to shave off half your beard.
That's not happening. $5? That is insult to the
I'm
beard.
Not made of money, dude.
$5. You could get a foot long for that.
Yeah, I see the value of my beard now.
Shave
Subway
off,
sandwich.
Shave off a foot of your beard, and I'll give you $5.
Take another run at us. Everyone come on home.